The U.S. Supreme Court sidestepping a big part of an abortion case, and in so doing, the High Court does not appear ready to test the landmark case of Roe versus Wade. So this was a new decision on a 2016 Indiana abortion law. The justices let stand a lower court's rule that blocks Indiana's ban on abortions motivated by race, sex, or disability. But the justices also allowed a part of the law that requires clinics to bury or cremate fetal remains. Joining us now to talk about this is Curtis Hill. He is the Attorney General of Indiana. Good morning, Mr. Hill. Thanks for being here.
Good morning. Thanks for having me.
So it sounds like you got this mixed decision. And what I want to focus in on is the first part that we just described, where Indiana had tried to block women from getting abortions if it were based on a disability. And I'm just curious about that one. Why would you want a family who have to have a child with a severe disability?
Well, the issue that the General Assembly faced was not with regard to the question you pose. It's the question of the rights and consideration of the unborn child in terms of discriminatory actions of eliminating that opportunity at life. Making a decision based solely on race or disability certainly is a discriminatory practice, and no decision in terms of whether or not to have a child should be based on that solely. And that's what the General Assembly chose to do in its ban.
But that confuses me, because as you know, there are lots of terminations of pregnancies based on the fact that there are severe abnormalities of a fetus. And so why would you take away that choice from a family?
Well, it's not a matter of taking away that choice. It's a matter of making a decision solely on the basis of not wanting a child because the child doesn't have a particular characteristic. We have certainly examples every day of children who appear to have disabilities or concerns or problems prenatal that are born and live very productive lives, and families who support those children. So it's a matter of whether or not it's appropriate to use that as a sole basis. And the court's decision, I think, was very interesting, because some might view it as a denial of Indiana's ban. I think it was something a little different. It was really a wait and see. The court used an appropriate standard of, we haven't seen this particular issue, let's let it percolate. I think that was Justice Thomas's words.
I think that you're right that they punted it. But again, I don't feel like I'm getting an answer to my question. Why would families in Indiana, why would lawmakers make them have to have a child with severe disabilities? How does that work? Why is that a good thing for the state of Indiana?
The Indiana General Assembly has looked from the standpoint of whether or not it's appropriate to seek an abortion solely on the basis of a characteristic that someone else chooses to not be appropriate. And that's the measure in which they've taken.
But we're talking about severe abnormalities where, as you know, some, like, let's be specific, okay? So chromosomal defect, trisomy 13 or 18, that child will have so many problems and will most likely not live past their first birthday. Why would lawmakers force parents to bring that child to fruition?
The law does not address issues with respect to severe abnormalities that would make a child unviable. That's not the point of this particular statute. This statute relates to decisions based on, this statute bases its decisions on discriminatory practices, simply making a decision to have an abortion based upon a characteristic that is unnecessary. And so
lots of families do have to make that decision based on the single characteristic of finding out that their children, that their fetus has a severe abnormality. That is the reality.
Well, the reality is the court will look this matter over in the future. I think the door is now open, and if states are paying attention, there is an avenue in which to move forward and determine through the various circuits what the appropriate standard would be. And when there's a conflict in that standard, we'll see the Supreme Court in all likelihood take action.
Yeah, I mean, I hear what you're saying. The Supreme Court punted. I get it. But what I don't still understand is why the Indiana legislature thought that they could force parents to have to care for a child with a severe life-threatening abnormality. What's the answer to that?
And I've told you that the Indiana General Assembly has not taken a position of forcing anyone to do anything.
That is what the law
interest
would do.
In Indiana, the interest in Indiana has been to provide protection to the unborn from decisions that are made that are uncharacteristic, making a determination that this is a child who's unwanted because of a discriminatory practice. And the General Assembly in Indiana believes appropriately that that's an inappropriate manner in which to make a choice of aborting a child.
And so, just help me understand this. If a woman goes in to a clinic in Indiana, if this Supreme Court decision hadn't happened, and had a child with severe disabilities, she would not be able to terminate that pregnancy.
Each case is an individual case. The severe disabilities in terms of a particular characteristic has to be determined by each child. As I said before, this is not a matter in which a child has is unviable or where a situation where the health of the mother is in question.
Mr. Hill, it just is. It is. The way the law was written, that does cover severe disabilities, and women in Indiana would not have been able to terminate those pregnancies. And the Supreme Court blocked that. They've punted it because they agreed with a lower court that doesn't make any sense. And so that's where we are today, and I just wanted to get your concept on the motivations for why Indiana felt that way, but we shall see what the Supreme Court does in the future. Mr. Curtis Hill, thank you very much for joining us.